Hi. This morning's scripture reading is taken from Isaiah chapter 59, verses 14 to 21. I'll be reading from the ESV. Verse 14. Justice is turned back and righteousness stands far away. For truth has stumbled in the public squares and uprightness cannot enter. Truth is lacking, and he who departs from evil makes himself a prey. The Lord saw it, and it displeased him that there was no justice. He saw that there was no man and wondered that there was no one to intercede. Then his own arm brought him salvation, and his righteousness upheld him. He put on righteousness as a breastplate and a helmet of salvation on his head. He put on garments of vengeance for clothing and wrapped himself in a zeal as a cloak. Verse 18, according to their deeds, so he will repay. Wrath to his adversaries, repayment to his enemies. To the coastlands he will render repayment. So they shall fear the name of the Lord from the west and his glory from the rising of the sun. For he will come like a rushing stream which the wind of the Lord drives. And a redeemer will come to Zion, to those in Jacob who turn from transgression, declares the Lord. And as for me, this is my covenant with them, says the Lord. My spirit that is upon you and my words that I have put in your mouth shall not depart out of your mouth or out of the mouth of your offspring or out of the mouth of your children's offspring, says the Lord, from this time forth and forevermore. May the Lord bless the public reading of his holy word. The Lord's messenger this morning is Mr. Quek Tze-Ming.
Thank you, Manu, and good morning, brothers and sisters. Well, we finished our studies through the Gospel of Luke last week, and we are preparing for Advent season, which begins next Sunday. So this week is a bit of a pause, from the pulpit at least. Shall we pray and ask God for wisdom? O triune God of grace, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, help us this morning to see your mighty works more clearly, to know who you are more fully, so that we might be touched more deeply to follow your calling for all our lives. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. The great Russian novelist Leo Tolstoy wrote a story called Two Old Men. Set in 19th century Russia, it tells the tale of two men, Ephim and Elisha, who decide that before they die, they must make a pilgrimage to Jerusalem. And after months of planning and preparation, Ephim and Elisha begin to walk. After a long day on the road, they come to a village that seems deserted. There's no one around. Seeing a small hut, they look in to see what has happened. They enter the darkness and they smell death. As their eyes adjust to the lack of light, they see bodies on beds. With some fear and trepidation, they come closer. And they see that, hey, the people are still alive, but barely. Elisha wants to stay and help. And so he encourages Ephim to go on to the next village. I'll catch up with you. But as Elisha opens doors and windows, offers food and drink to those lying on beds, he begins to see that their needs are more complicated than he first thought. And that it's not only them, but the whole village that's suffering. He finds his friend Ephim and tells him that he wants to stay longer. And he encourages Ephim to make his way to Jerusalem by himself. I'll find you, he says. You go on ahead. And so one man stays in the village, helping the villagers to find their way again to happiness and health. He never goes on to Jerusalem, eventually returns home. The other man makes his way to Jerusalem, but he is dissatisfied with what he finds and what he does not find. He visits the places that are meant to inspire, but he never is inspired. He's always looking for his friend, expecting him to arrive any day now, but before long he decides that his pilgrimage is over and he returns home to Russia, again walking all the way back. At one point along the long journey back, Efim comes to a village that seems strangely familiar. And then he realizes that it is where he left his friend. But everything seems very different now. Men and women, old and young, are busy at work and play. Animals are healthy, the crops are growing. And so he asks, what's happened? The villagers explain that a man stopped by along the way and gave them back their health, their life. The story ends with both Efim and Elisha finally at home in Russia, sharing a bottle of vodka and telling the stories of their respective pilgrimages. The author, Steve Garber, from whom I first got this story, tells us that the author Tolstoy has no desire to tell a black and white story with a good guy and a bad guy. His story is more nuanced than this. Life is more nuanced than this. And the last lines of the story speak of the joy of two old men meeting again, together again. But for those who have ears to hear and eyes to see and noses to smell, clearly one man paid more attention than the other. Clearly one man knew and acted on the needs around him. He could see and literally smell something. Something that he knew implicated him. And he began to understand that his pilgrimage was the village, full of sorrow and hope as it was. Now, this business of seeing and knowing ourselves as implicated is an important one as we live our lives day to day. Seeing what you see, knowing what you know, how will you respond? It's a question that human beings have asked ourselves over and over again in every century and in every culture. It's a question we ask today, whether you're in business, in church work, in public service, or at home as a homemaker. Seeing what you see, knowing what you know, how will you respond? Or to use the words in today's sermon title, does what you see and know touch you? Does what you see and know touch you? This is a difficult question because there's both risk and cost with knowledge. The English poet Lord Byron once wrote, "They who know the most must mourn the deepest." They who know the most must mourn the deepest. In this part of his dramatic poem, Manfred, Lord Byron is reflecting on the relationship between knowledge and responsibility. Byron argues that knowledge is weighty, that in fact it can be burdensome. They who know the most must mourn the deepest. And so, knowing more, we protect ourselves. A lot of the time, we do not want to be responsible for what we know. Why? It's too risky. It costs too much. It hurts too much to know. In Tolstoy's story, one old man saw the villages, and he knew, and he was touched to act. The other old man saw the same things, but he chose not to know, and was not touched to act. Perhaps that second old man thought it was risky to stay and offer help. Perhaps he thought he might himself catch whatever it was that the villagers were suffering from. Maybe he thought of his carefully laid plans for his pilgrimage and how much it might cost him if he stayed and helped. In the Hebrew worldview of the Old Testament, to know is to be responsible for, to care for. If one knows, then one cares. If one does not care, then maybe one does not really know. But most of the time, we prefer a disconnect. We do not want knowing to necessarily mean caring or even acting. Like Lord Byron, we realize instinctively that the one who knows the most mourns the deepest. More often, we think that more knowledge means more pain. Now, that's not to say that if we live our lives with our eyes open, we are miserable all the time. Patently, there are times when at work or in school or at home, in whatever vocation God has called us into, we are able to find fulfillment and satisfaction and joy. Let me tell you a bit about Jerry. Jerry from our congregation who works in the police force. Jerry tells us of an occasion that brought him much fulfillment in his vocation. In fact, this was his first remand case. The accused person was a Christian who committed a serious crime and so needed to be remanded in a police station for further investigations and interviews. This is what Jerry says, and I'm quoting from him, I'm reading out loud from what he says. "I was firm with him, and he was cooperative and expressed remorse over what he had done. During one of my interviews with him, he also briefly told me about his strained relationship with his wife and daughter. I told him that I was also a Christian and that I would pray for him. After investigations were completed and after he had served his time, I met him again to return some of his possessions that were seized from him as exhibits. He then told me about how he had spent his time well in prison and how he has now integrated himself into a Christian community that's helping him to get him back on his feet. He also shared with me about how he has been actively working to rebuild the strained relationship with his family. This experience really lifted my heart and made me feel that God was at work and I was serving God at my workplace." And so, as you can see, as Jerry has indicated, we can experience fulfillment, encouragement, as we live out our vocations in the world. But at the same time, we also know that the world we live in contains disappointment and heartbreak and injustice. Jerry continues. "Apart from the experience mentioned above," Jerry says, "almost everything else at work has left me feeling drained and discouraged. One of the more discouraging aspects of work is the fact that there is so much brokenness in everything I witness at church, at work. It is sin at work in a family, in the schools, in the workplace, almost everywhere. I guess this is not just reserved for policing work, but simply more clearly seen in the course of policing work. What makes this worse is the fact that the police officers, myself included, are often not any better, and yet we often take a high-handed stance when dealing with the cases. What I'm trying to say is that brokenness is not just seen in the work I do, but also in the workers of the work I do, and this really discourages me." And that's what Jerry says. Things are often not as they are supposed to be. Knowing the world to be this way, knowing our experience to be this way, what can Jerry do? How can he respond? How will we respond? Or take Pastor Howren, our pastor in charge of foreign missions. Pastor Howren tells of his meeting with Brother Benny, a successful lawyer from South India, who heeded the call of the Lord, gave up his practice, and became an evangelist and church planter in Nepal. By the grace of God, Benny and his wife started something called the House of Compassion, a ministry for orphans. That was 17 years ago. Today, Benny and his team have established 6 such homes in Nepal, providing free education, food, and shelter for those who need it. And they have planted churches in these communities. For Pastor Howren, what is especially inspiring is the fact that this is entirely a faith ministry. Benny and his team depend solely on God's provision through well wishes. They draw from a common pool for ministry needs and living expenses. There's no salary structure for Benny and his staff. Neither does the ministry solicit support from churches or other sources. When asked about his ministry plans for the future, Benny said to Howren with a humble, charming smile, "Brother, we have no plans. We pray and listen to the Lord. He will tell us what to do. We just obey." For Pastor Howren, one of the most encouraging things about his mission trips is when he gets to meet up with indigenous ministry workers like Brother Benny. But in other trips, or perhaps often in the same trip, Howren also experiences the burden and weight of seeing and knowing the great needs that still exist. And this is what Pastor Howren said, and I'm quoting from him. "I felt quite overwhelmed by the plight of the suffering Rohingya refugees when I visited the camps at Cox's Bazaar in Bangladesh recently. I felt the same last month when I saw the extent of destruction and the suffering of the locals as a result of the earthquakes in Lombok. Knowing the world to be this way, yes, bright lights of encouragement, but also unrelenting darkness of brokenness. Knowing our experience to be this way, what can Pastor Howren do? How can he respond? How will we respond?" So over time, we human beings, we have responded to this relationship between knowledge and responsibility in one of two ways. The Greeks called these responses stoicism and cynicism. Now they sound very difficult, very intellectual, but actually other cultures also have similar responses, even if they don't use the same terms. Now, both stoicism and cynicism offer a way to know that allows us to keep our eyes somewhat open, seeing things as they really are, but not requiring that we get so close that we are hurt by what we know. They allow us to protect ourselves from knowing too much and therefore from caring too much. The Stoic response is apatheia, a way of knowing that does not require you to respond. Apatheia is a Greek word we don't use today, but we do use the closely related English word apathy, meaning disinterest. We stand apart, not my business. For the Stoic, the goal of life is to be happy, and anything that gets in the way of happiness is to be avoided. And so when the Stoic sees suffering, darkness, pain, brokenness, all of which we know exists, he or she does not have to step in. The Stoic knows, but does not have to be touched, does not have to be implicated. Now, if truth be told, sometimes we also negotiate life like Stoics. Maybe some of us have encountered reports of human suffering, like those of the Rohingya, or with the natural disaster in Lombok. And yes, it's overwhelming. We ask ourselves, what can I do? And then we move on quickly to, well, maybe it's not my business. Someone else will do it. And so we turn to the next page of the newspaper or to the next prayer item in the bulletin. The other response is cynicism. The basic cynic response can be summed up with the phrase, get real. Get real. Rather than being taught by the gods or by some holy book or scripture, the cynics saw life as it is as a teacher. So no high-sounding ideals, no ideal world to come. We learn from this world as it is the way we are to live. Look around you. See for yourself, the cynics say. Stop imagining a world that does not exist. Be real. And if truth be told, sometimes we also negotiate life like cynics. How often have we heard this advice from colleagues or friends or relatives? Advice like, yes, of course, those are good practices in theory, good values for the church, but this is the real world, the business world, and we have to do this to survive. And so we have these two responses to the relationship between knowledge and responsibility, stoicism and cynicism. They allow us to protect ourselves from knowing too much and therefore from caring too much or getting so close that we are hurt by what we know. And these responses might have been adequate answers to the question of knowledge and responsibility if we didn't have the incarnation. The incarnation is that one supreme moment in history that demonstrated how God sees and God knows completely all our darkness and suffering and rebellion, and still God loves and acts. In the prophetic word that Isaiah didn't give, the Lord saw justice beaten back, righteousness banished far off, truth stumbling around, honesty nowhere to be found, good is MIA, missing in action. And the Lord saw all this, but he was unmoved. The Lord saw that there was no man, no one to intercede, no one to turn the situation around. So what did he do? God did nothing. That's the prophetic word that Isaiah did not give. During the month of December, as I said, our Advent series of sermons will be from Isaiah. We are going to look forward to Christmas from the perspective of Isaiah. In Isaiah's time, the people of God were in a bad way. They are suffering in exile, having been vomited out of the promised land because of persistent idolatry and injustice, sin. And in Isaiah, we hear them crying out to God to see, to act, to rescue. And in the scripture reading for today, in the word that Isaiah did give, the Lord sees. And the Lord knows full well the desperate and helpless condition of the people. And in verse 15, the Lord saw it, and it displeased him that there was no justice. He saw that there was no man and wondered if there was no one to intercede. Then his own arm brought him salvation, and his righteousness upheld him. He put on righteousness as a breastplate, a helmet of salvation on his head. He put on garments of vengeance for clothing and wrapped himself in zeal as a cloak. The prophet has a vision of the Lord acting in person. It's as if God looked around and asked, anybody? Anybody can help? No one? And so he said, I'll do it myself. I'll do it myself. It's as if God puts on a warrior's armor and he fights the battle against sin himself. The results are in Isaiah's future because verse 20 says, and a redeemer will come to Zion. But from our perspective, that signal event of all history happened 2,000 years ago. The incarnation of the Word of God. God doing it himself. God becoming man. As Eugene Peterson puts it so poignantly in his translation of John 1:14 in the Message, the Word became flesh and blood and moved into the neighborhood. Our neighborhood. God saw our plight. God knew the full extent of how sinful and rebellious we are. And still God was touched. And God cared enough to act, to move into this often messy and broken and painful circumstances of our neighborhood. And in so doing, God touched us. And we are never the same again. And that's why we're celebrating the Advent season, looking forward to Christmas. And so here we have God's answer to the question of see, know, and touch. God sees. God knows. God himself puts on his armor and fights the war on our behalf. And in a strange and wonderful twist that shows forth God's wisdom, you might say that God's armor, what he puts on to fight, turns out to be our frail humanity, our flesh and blood. God became man. And for those of us who are in Christ, this provides a model for us to think through how we see, know, and touch. We can see, we can know, and we can be touched to act in the messiness of life. And these acts, they may seem small or frail or futile. These acts may be in Christian ministry or in your workplace as you work out your business, your public service, or your homemaking with excellence and integrity and care. As long as we act in faith and in love and in hope, as long as we act in Christ, we are participating in God's project to restore all of broken creation to Himself. We don't have to be like the Stoics and quarantine ourselves from caring. We don't have to be like the cynics and live as though the world cannot be changed. We don't have to disconnect knowing from caring and acting. In the relationships and responsibilities of life, we see ourselves as implicated in the way the world is and the way the world ought to be. Why? Because of love. Because God has moved into our neighborhood. Because we are responsible. We are response-able. Able to respond. What are we responding to? To God's call. We are called to imitate Him in love. Let me end by giving you a couple of more stories from you, from members of the congregation. This is from our worship leader, Mervin, who runs, as you know, a successful and varied business in the challenging F&B sector. One of the businesses is a cooking, team building, and events company. The company uses food to facilitate team building and build stronger relationships in organizations. And this is what Mervin says. And maybe I should ask Mervin to come out and read next one. I will read what he says. Whenever we have a successful cooking event, people generally feel a closer bond through cooking together, almost like bringing people like a kampong in the past, or people enjoying the food that we prepare in our restaurants that we take pride in serving. We feel the joy and sense of pride whenever people are satisfied in the things we do. When I asked Mervin what keeps him doing what he does, this is his reply. What keeps us going, Mervin says, are the relationships that we build along the way with our staff, with customers, and even suppliers that mean a lot to us. We definitely still have a lot of improvements to be made, but we do not want to give up. We know that God will also not want us to give up. By His will, we go on to see where He leads. And so here you see it. Relationships. Actually, he tells me that staff departures are very hard for him. Because when it happens, Mervin says he stays up at night wondering if it was due to any lack on his part. Mervin and his team, they are implicated in the lives of staff, customers, and even suppliers. A final story from Cindy, a social worker in a family service center. Cindy told me about one particular family she worked with. In this family, the woman and her children suffered severe domestic violence for 20 years, and Cindy worked with her for almost 4 years, the last 4 years of those 20 years of abuse. This is Cindy in her own words. I saw many moments of despair and pain, Cindy says, especially in the first 2 years. Even as the ex-husband was abusive and recalcitrant, I saw how sin had kept him tightly in bondage. There was a deep sense of helplessness during the first 2 years of work with this family. I remember praying for this family, worrying that another episode of violence can easily end up into a homicide. God, these are your children too, I prayed. Save them from themselves. I always hung on to John 16:33. He who has overcome the world has overcome sin. So I did whatever that was humanly and professionally possible and waited for God to come through for them. For this family, God came through for them 2 years later and pulled them out of the bondage of violence, abuse, and trauma. The next 2 years were spent helping the family heal from the decades of violence and abuse. Again, I saw for myself how little I could do to reverse the damage done. But in it, I remember that he has overcome the world. I need only to continue to do what was necessary to show Christ's love through the relationships I built with them. Not every family I work with has a happy ending, Cindy says, but each one continues to be an encouragement. For in each family, I have the privilege of entering into that sacred space of vulnerability and resilience. And I see God coming through for them in small and big ways. So this is Cindy. She's not naive. She knows what she's dealing with. She's clear-eyed about what she's dealing with. She knows the darkness and the brokenness in this family. And at times, she says, she felt helpless. What could she do? But she didn't take the path of the stoic and quarantine herself from feeling. She didn't take the path of the cynic and say, these people are like that. The system is like that. You cannot change anything. She remained implicated, responsible, response-able. And I love what she said at the end. For in each family, I have the privilege of entering into that sacred space of vulnerability and resilience. And I see God coming through for them in small and big ways. Both Mervyn and Cindy practiced see, know, touch. What about you? Whether you are in business or in church work or in public service or at home as a homemaker, seeing what you see, knowing what you know, how will you respond? Does what you see and know touch you? In what ways are you implicated for love's sake, for God's sake? In what ways are you responsible, response-able? As we think on these questions, I'll give you some time to reflect, and then I will pray. Lord, we see your example in the Word become flesh into the messiness of our lives. This is the model and this is our vocation, our calling, to be implicated in our daily lives and relationships around us. May we hear and may we answer this call that you have given us so that we are responsible, we are responsible to you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.